This man has talent. Of its kind, one of the most exceptional new talents the world has seen in 25 years. Born with a gift from nature, polished by years of painstaking work, and between the ages of 7 and 17, the best teaching that could possibly be found. A well-spent youth that established him with an international career before he was 21. His name is Pinchas Zukerman, and he plays the violin.
I made it.
28, take one.
Ow. Sink the second time.
Go. Okay, it's not my finger.
It's just a classic, guys. Go on.
This man also had talent, and he too played the violin, but no more. His name is Yehuda Zukerman. He was born in Poland, was entirely self-taught, and supported his family with his fiddle from the age of 14.
Bloody hell.
Both he and his wife survived the Warsaw Ghetto and were among the few to survive the Auschwitz extermination camp. They left Poland in 1946, with the clothes they stood up in and their livelihood, the family fiddle.
A key guy's trick. A cause guy's trick. Ein Moment, Sekunde, Sekunde.
In 1948, in Israel, they had a son. And in the strange way that talent can pass from one generation to another, apparently flowering in the process, Pinchas Zukerman seemed to start from where his father left off.
Fear. He's screaming me, baby.
By the time he was 12, those who knew about the fiddle and about talent knew that this boy had something which might, one day, put him among the great violinists of all time. This recording was made in 1958, before he was 10 years old.
Thank you.
I first played recorder when I was around 4. I learned to read music. And then I played clarinet a short while after that. I played for about 6 months, I played clarinet. And then I had some trouble breathing and things like that. And my father decided that it was a good time for me to start learning the violin. I was about 7 and a half then. He bought me a half-size instrument, and he started teaching me a little bit to tune it. And the first thing I learned to do is to tune. It was one of the most important things he thought was to tune, so nobody else takes the fiddle out of your hand again to tune it for you, you know, a sort of physical thing which is important. So I learned how to tune, and that right away made me conscious of hearing, of listening automatically. And then I played a little bit, and we started playing duets together after about a month and a half, very simple sort of Mozart's duet. And then one Sunday morning, we went over to Saturday, as a matter of fact, Saturday, we went over to my teacher, Ilona Fair, and she said she couldn't take me because she had too many students and there was absolutely no time for her. And she said, but she will listen to me in any case. And so I took out the fiddle, and her first impression was, because I tuned the instrument, she was so absolutely stunned. You know, I could hardly play, but I could tune my instrument. And she was so amazed by that. She said, come tomorrow at 7 o'clock in the evening.
Er war ein Kind mit voll Leben und Temperament.
As a child, he was full of life and fun. And with other children, he played and fooled about, like any one of them.
Und hat sich herumgeschlagen die ganze Zeit. Aber in diesem Moment, wo die Violine in Hand genommen hat, war ein ganz anderer Mensch.
But the moment he had the fiddle in his hand, he was a different person. There was a transformation, and what one felt one saw was his soul.
Aber die Hauptsache, seine Seele. Hat mit so einem Temperament gespielt, dass die Leute konnten nicht ruhig sitzen auf dem Platz, wenn gespielt hat. Und das ist heute auch so.
When Ilona Feher says that the audience could not sit still in their seats, she means exactly what she says. And the temperament which he describes was obvious not only to musicians. Listen to what happens at the end of the first movement cadenza in Mozart's fourth concerto, recorded at a public concert when Pinchas Zukerman was 12. That recording was made in 1961, when he was 12 years old. Here, 12 years later, is the other side of that same temperament. The end of the slow movement of the same Mozart concerto, filmed in Munich in 1973 with the English Chamber Orchestra. Thank you.
I was born in Tel Aviv, in a hospital which doesn't exist anymore. And the first few years of my life, we lived in a, what's called in Hebrew, tzrif. It's a little sort of a shack, which were, the Swedes were kind enough to give us material to build those shacks. And there was water, when it was raining, water leaked in. When it was hot, it was too hot. It was, when it was cold, it was too cold. And then after 5 years, we moved to Holon. I remember I used to play football here. When we first came to live here from Tel Aviv, when I was 5 years old, these three houses were here. We lived in this one right here. And there was nothing, it was absolutely white. All these things are painted since then. Nothing, it was absolutely isolated, it was beautiful. Hello. I was about that age.
He lived here in Holon, on the outskirts of Tel Aviv, for the next 7 years. Then, at the age of 12, Isaac Stern and Pablo Casals heard him play and said that this talent was too big to leave in Israel. He should go to America to study at Juilliard with Ivan Galamian.
Feel that, feel that. Can you feel that? It's like pure sand, it's pure gold. Absolutely beautiful. You see, what happened was, when I went to America, you know, my impression first was that I was going to play. I was going to study, but I was going to play because of all the fuss that was made here in New York, in Israel, about me. And here I was going to New York, and I was, you know, the big star. And I got there, and I went to Galamian for the first time, and he said, "You're starting tomorrow with Kreutzer, you know, the exercises again." And it was, for me, such a shock. Here I was playing every day almost in Israel, anywhere possible. And then I got to Galamian, and he says, "You know, you're beginning from the beginning." And it was unbelievable shock.
I know that he's going to be a violinist. He's not going to be my child.
When I first walked down the streets, I thought the whole place is going to collapse, because it gives you that feeling when you're looking down. It gives you that feeling that the whole buildings are just going to come together, because it's all the skyscrapers, you know, they're just so huge. I was scared, believe me, I was scared. I had my first... Are you running?
Yeah, go on, sure.
I had my first traumatic experience, because I had a bow. I got a bow from my teacher in Israel. And, these huge radiators they have in the hotels here. It's so hot. And I was practicing one day because I heard that I had to play for Galamian. And I was practicing, and the bow tightened because of the heat. The bow tightened, and I was playing Bruch Concerto, last movement, and I went, "Wah!" And the bow split. And it was such a traumatic experience, because it was a bow as a present for my teacher, going away sort of present. There was nothing I could do, and I didn't know what to do. And so I didn't speak any English, so the only person I went to was my sponsor, and she took me down on 42nd Street to Mrs. Wulitzer. It was my first encounter with the Wulitzer shop. And I got myself a lousy bow, which I didn't like, and it was terrible. It was a terrible experience.
Didn't you expect Isaac to lend you his bow?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I did. And I was stupidly saying in Hebrew that Isaac Stern has got 7 bows, and why can't I have 7, you know? And which I got yelled for afterwards, because I was chutzpahdik and arrogant and so on. Anyway.
So the transplant was not an unqualified success. He found himself alone in New York at 13, without a word of English, and in difficulties with his schooling, his relationships, and with his playing.
Look at that monster. Awful. I wasn't able to play at all. At that time, I started doing funny things. I started smoking, which I shouldn't have done. I started playing pool, which I shouldn't have done. I don't know, now that I think about it back, I don't know if I should or shouldn't have. I think it was good and bad. And I had some problems at home with these stormings. I guess it's all growing up pains in a way. Except for me, it was doubly hard because I was by myself. I was terribly, I was very down at that time. I was beginning to feel that I really wasn't getting anywhere. And I knew that I had something to say, and that I had no way of saying it on the fiddle. And any way I could, I had to bring it out. The only way I could do it at that time was to go into the Leventry. And I worked damn hard for it. And I went into the competition not knowing the risks, but I went into the competition, I played very well the second round. The third round, I didn't play so well. I almost fell on my tuches, actually. But I made it. And I went right away, I got a CBS contract because of Stern, the help of Stern, and I began my career in 67, I began to play.
Spoleto, 1967. His first time in Europe at the age of 19, and his first contact with established professional musicians on an equal footing. He's been invited by Giancarlo Menotti to play in the chamber music concerts at the Spoleto Festival.
Sunday is Pinky's birthday.
Yeah.
Now, a
good.
Secret.
Yeah, very good.
Secret.
Yeah, yeah.
But
what?
When he says to you, all are you ready?
Yes, yes.
I want all of you to play.
Yes, yes, what?
Happy birthday. Do you know that?
We played tremendous amount of music. In midday in Spoleto, we played concerts in midday very informally without without jackets and ties. And it's a wonderful, wonderful atmosphere. And that's the way music should be played. Very just to the people, the way it is. In 67, I went the first time, and I spent the next two summers again in Spoleto. Except there was a small difference. In 68, I got married in May. To a wonderful girl called, at that time, Jeannie Rich. We went, she plays flute as well, and we played together, we played alone, she played, I played, I listened to her, she listened to me. So it was a little bit like a honeymoon.
My memories of Spoleto are very, very dreamlike. We went there the first summer, was our very first trip to Europe, and everything was like a fairy tale. And in Spoleto, we had a marvelous apartment. It was from 1492, and neither of us had really seen any of the splendors, so to speak, of Europe, and it was terrifically exciting. It was also the first time either of us had played professionally in a solo manner before a public. And it was very important, I think, that Pinky liked it and that he thrived on it and that they seemed to like him. And Spoleto is such a beautiful, beautiful place. everything has happened rather suddenly and in a kind of whirlwind fashion. He entered the Leventrid competition in 1967 and won it, luckily. I say luckily only because the competition was such a difficult thing to go through for both of us, and for him especially, because it had never been questioned for him. He had never been had to sort of put himself on the line, and I think competing is completely against his nature and against his whole concept of music. I think he likes chamber music and the whole idea of making music with people, not kind of showing off or having to prove yourself, in a sense. And I think had he not won, things wouldn't have taken off so quickly. I think he wasn't ready for it. I don't think one is ever really ready if things happen so fast.
New York, 1969. The CBS recording studios to make his first gramophone record at the age of 20.
Oh, goodness.
The conductor is Leonard Bernstein, the orchestra of the New York Philharmonic, and the concerto, the Mendelssohn.
Some fermata. Keep up with you. We're together, though. A little ahead of us.
In the early stages, I was terribly influenced by Heifetz. I had many Heifetz records, which I think every fiddler has through the lifetime, through his studies. It's just the man has something so very special that it's very, very special. It's something, it's a sound, and when you listen to it on the radio, you know it's Heifetz. There's nobody else. You can't mistake it. And there's an influence in that. But then after that, because of my association with Stern, I think I became a little more aware of other things that go into playing the violin. And there was Isaac, and then there was Casals later on because of the association again. And then from Casals became the Budapest Quartet, which came to Israel regularly. I would say that those people basically are those three, four people that, because later on you just pick up from people here and there, but it never was influence, as far as influence directly like that, was in my early age, it was those people. And later on was co-association with somebody like Barenboim, which now has become a trio, with Jackie, which is now a marvelous thing, because we communicate. I've never communicated to two other people the same way I do, music on a musical level, the same way I do to those two. And it's a different, there's a rapport which is a very rare thing, I think, in music. And it happens very few times. It's, to me, in any case, it's happened so far very twice in my life.
London, to prepare for a series of trio concerts around England, to put all the Beethoven trios on record, and one of them, The Ghost, onto film.
I think the chamber music is a very important part in everybody's training. only fiddlers, but every musician should. Chamber music for me is the basics to everything, because it means, chamber music means playing with other people, which makes you right away confront you with listening to other people. Makes you, your whole structure of playing and thinking changes automatically. You yourself are not the main point. It becomes the two other people or the three other people that you play with, and that becomes one body, one unit.
In August 1969, when Daniel Barenboim was musical director of London's South Bank Summer Music, he invited Zubin Mehta and Itzhak Perlman to join them for a now famous performance of Schubert's Trout Quintet. Itzhak Perlman played the violin, and since Zukerman is equally at home on either instrument, he played the viola. April 1971. At long last, his official New York debut recital. He's now 22 and well aware that this is one of the most important hurdles in the difficult transition from boy wonder to accepted concert artist. The pianist is Lawrence Smith. Thank you.
No, I don't think I played well. I think I could have done much better. There were certain things that distracted me. I was many things, many thoughts. One while playing, you know, because of, I don't know, the first time in New York, and because I lived here. I think one gets more nervous when one is in his hometown, so to speak, where you know that your friends know every move that you make, and it's sometimes a little more nerve-wracking. I don't get as nervous in London, I must say.
I think he does a little bit. I can always tell if he's nervous if he spends a lot of time in the bathroom for a concert. But he doesn't ever say, gee, I'm nervous. The only time he said that he was nervous was for his New York debut recital. I think because he had been a student here and because he felt so much was expected of him and he wanted so much to do well here.
Well, sure, because when I arrived, I was a kid and I had no strings attached at all. And as you grow older, I think it gets more and more difficult to get on that stage. There are more physical problems, there are more psychological problems that get into playing, and it's basically much harder. There are many more things that involve it.
But if you feel like that at 23, what are you going to feel like at 50?
God knows.
Copenhagen, May 1971. Less than a month after his New York recital, on tour for the first time with the English Chamber Orchestra. He has already begun to build a very rewarding partnership with these musicians. A number of highly successful concerts with them as soloist produced such an immediate response to his playing that they've invited him on this tour to play Bach and Vivaldi without a conductor. The experiment is less risky than it might seem. This is an orchestra of true chamber music players, capable of performing very well without a conductor at all, and many of them soloists in their own right. So both for them and for Zukerman, the real question is whether they'll get as much enjoyment from each other's playing as they're all anticipating.
Thank you.
London, a few days after the tour, to play the Spohr and Mendelssohn octets in the Queen Elizabeth Hall with members of the English Chamber Orchestra. Mendelssohn wrote the octet when he was 16 and succeeded miraculously in combining flawless inspiration, technical virtuosity, and the exuberance of youth.
I never cease to be amazed at the range of achievement of this artist. Everything seems to be in style. He's such a tremendous musician. I think that he could probably succeed at anything he wanted to do. He's a born chamber music player, concerto player, conductor, anything you like. Well, to me, he's the greatest talent the world's had for the last 25 years.
Thank you.
See, I think that music is an international language. And when it's spoken with feeling and it's spoken with understanding, there's no other language that's more beautiful, I think. Absolutely the greatest. You don't have to know alphabets. You don't have to know little punctuation marks. It's there and it just speaks to you.
Talent of this caliber deserves a fiddle to match. But the best violins were made a long time ago and now cost incredible sums if they can be found at all. Until recently, they've been beyond his reach.
I didn't have my ring.
And for the past few years, he's been lent a Stradivari. But now, with the help of Charles Beer, he has his own fiddle for the first time, a Guarneri.
Everybody was getting very anxious about finding Pinky a fiddle because the Stradivari which he was borrowing had to be given back. And we were sort of telephoning all over the world to see if there was one that would be available. In fact, we bought tickets to go to Frankfurt on a Saturday morning at 6 a.m. and drive 20 miles, and we were going to see a Stradivari that was going to cost four times too much money, but it didn't matter anything. And then suddenly I heard that this one was available, and I sort of thought this might suit him. So we got it along, and he played it, and it was hopeless, and then we fiddled around with it a bit, and suddenly there it was, and we knew we were okay for a year or two.
Well, because it seems to suit my hand. It seems to suit my sound. It seems to suit, I don't know, just that I've heard other people play on it. They don't sound as good. I don't know why those things, I don't know. Can you?
I don't know what it is, but I think every player wants something different. Pinky's more at home on a Guarneri of some sort than on a much more valuable Stradivari, for instance. Another player would be exactly the reverse. He could only bring out the best in himself on a Stradivari.
Strat, I had to do this. I had to shake my head in order to make it work, you know, to give the same effect. Well, here I can really dig in.
Munich, May 1973. On tour again with the English Chamber Orchestra. They have already completed a world tour, and the relationship has now developed to the point where he's to conduct Haydn and Mozart symphonies for the first time. There are two sides to touring in this way. The opportunity to work daily with Zukerman for 2 weeks or more produces musical results that give real pleasure and which could not be achieved in the normal concert routine. But physically, the rigors of touring are appalling. To make this tour pay, they must give 15 concerts in 18 days from Brighton to Berlin. Even then, it does not pay as well as simply staying in London. But they put up with it for the musical results and for the pure liveliness of making music in this way.
Well, we discuss ideas, and at the concert, we usually change them. Again, it's all. I can never play one thing twice, you know. I can never do anything the same. From day to day, I feel differently. From 1 hour to the other, I feel differently. And if you can communicate that, either with gestures or by gestures or by just smiling at somebody, that makes that thing click, you know.
They're to play Mozart's fourth violin concerto and the Symphony No. 29. They've been rehearsing the symphony for some time and are already enthusiastic about the results. But there's some apprehension about how the public and the critics will react to his conducting for the first time. Nevertheless, since it's to be something of an occasion, they've agreed to the concert being filmed for television, which provokes trouble of a completely unexpected kind.
Whoever doesn't want to stay should leave right now. We are here to make music. Please. Yes, I'll give you personally the money back. You go ahead and leave right now. Go. Please, get out. All right?
Shut up. Get out.
Well, I'm sorry to tell you, my dear friend, but you have very bad taste in that case, if it's a matter of taste. I hate to tell you. How many times, let me ask you a question, how many times have you been in a concert when it's been filmed?
Never before.
Okay, I've played in concerts where it's been filmed. And I can tell you that I have never, and I've played in many, many places, including Germany, never in my whole life have I had this kind of problem, ever.
Some sections of the press made much of the protest. But the protester did not, in fact, leave the hall. And in spite of the tension, or perhaps even because of it, they succeeded in making the concert which followed one of the liveliest of the tour.
Thank you.
it's spoken with feeling and it's spoken with understanding. There's no other language that's more beautiful, I think. It's there and it just speaks to you.
Thank you.